My name is Becky Taylor, and I've been with the St. Tammany Parish Library System, since the mid-80s, as a librarian. And I'm interviewing today Miss Judy Wood, who I've known since I came to St. Tammany Parish. She was one of the people who interviewed me, and she has been involved locally in the Slidell area, in government, in civic affairs, instrumental in starting the Friends of the Slidell Library, on the Library Board of Control, and it's my pleasure to interview her today and have her relate about all her involvement over her year, the years here in our area.
Great.
So thank you, Judy, for agreeing to sit here with me and talk to me.
It's always fun to talk about libraries.
Oh, it most definitely is. So you're not a native of Louisiana. Can you tell me about your background? Mm-hmm. I mean, where you grew up, what was your first involvement with libraries? And
sure. I grew up in Toledo, Ohio. And I can remember as a child, even before I could read, going to the library every week, particularly with my dad, but sometimes with my mother, and having the pleasure of picking out three or four books and taking them home. And it was just a weekly treat to go with. And I also remember at this same beautiful library in the west side of Toledo, getting my first library card and being able to pick out my library books to take home. And from there, libraries have always been part of my life. When I was old enough to ride the bus, I would go downtown to the big library with its lovely children's center and check out books there. And then also, because we didn't have computers then, whenever we wanted to do any research for high school papers or anything like that, we always went to the big library to get information. Ultimately, I learned about going to the libraries at our university, the University of Toledo. My high school had a good library, and so I was just always thought of the library as my dear friend, and loved it. So when I lived in other parts of the country and always had a really good library experience there, Iowa City, Iowa had a nice library mm-hmm. system. And we moved in 1973 to Slidell from Iowa City, Iowa. So the first week I was in Slidell, I went to the library to get my library card. And of course,
And where was that library?
That library was on Erlinger, okay. And I think it would have been 4th Street. Mm-hmm. It was a very small library. Compared to what I was used to. And even though it was a small library, the collection was also very small. There was a lot of space that was open and not filled with materials. So I wanted my library card, and I went to apply for the library card and was told that without two male references, I could not have a library card. And these, I think, needed to be men who they could find in the phone book. Mm-hmm. And so I didn't know anybody in Slidell. We moved here because my husband was working in New Orleans. And so I had heard of a couple men. One of them was a neighbor across the street, and another was a man that I'd met at a restaurant. And so I used their names and got my library card. So that was my first experience there.
And did your children come with you on their first
visit? I believe they did. But I don't, because I had such a difficulty getting my library card, I don't recall getting one for them. And at that point, they were just 4 and 5. So they weren't quite into that. And also, we had extensive book collections at home. So it wasn't the resource that they needed like I needed as a child growing up. But I always looked at the library as the cornerstone of the community and where I had my roots for the community. If I was going to make friends or anything like that, it needed to be part of the library system. Mm-hmm. So,
besides the restrictions on obtaining a library card, did you find the materials that you wanted there?
The collection was really very limited, and I didn't understand about interlibrary loans, those kinds of things. So I wasn't used to having to use that. The librarians, although they were very friendly and everything, the collection was very personal for them. So they weren't, you know, they weren't really excited about having someone come in there who really wanted all this things. It was just how they viewed their library at the time. It was their library. So we may do in other ways. There were many young mothers who moved to Slidell at the same time, because that's when Martin Marietta came in, and lots of other people from Denver and other parts. And they came to Slidell because of the schools and because of the proximity to Michu, where they were, and Stennis. I was not there for that. My husband was at Charity Hospital teaching. But we all were at a loss for resources for our children. And yet we chose to be in this community. I think many of us, because we really believed in public schools, and St. Tammany had a reputation of having good public schools. So this group of mothers got together and decided that we would have to create our own environment. And that's how one of the persons was Ida Parker, who eventually was an employee of this library. And Lucy Wilcox, she was very much into libraries. Pat Hedges, who's the past judge, and many others. So we all moved within two blocks of each other. Lots and lots of children. So that was 1973. We, as a group of women, created our own book club, read books, because we wanted to understand the South. So the first book, or one of the first books we read, was Faulkner, The Sound and the Fury, because we thought that would help us understand the South. I'm not sure it was the right choice, but we did do that. And then ultimately, the next summer, 1974, we decided that we needed to provide something for our children during the summer vacation. And so we created in our own neighborhood, which was Broadmoor in Slidell, Summer Fun. And that was just summer fun in the neighborhood. And what we did there is every Tuesday and Thursday, one mother was in charge of an activity and had another mother help. And we had children from preschool all the way through junior high that would participate. So it was a great mix of children. And then on the other day of the week, we would take a tour someplace in the greater New Orleans area that would take a group of about 20 children and their parent, their mothers, and we would go explore the art museums, parks, anything that we could. I remember even going to the newspaper in Slidell, the Daily Times, anything we could get a tour with for the children. And so we did that whole summer. And this started to grow because we met other mothers in the community who felt the same way. And so in the summer of 75, we branched out because we knew that from the library we could get free films from the state. But the library didn't have a projector. None of us had a projector that could handle those films. So what we did is we raised money and purchased a projector for the library. Many citizens in the community donated until we got that. And the Methodist Church, which was across the street from the library, allowed us to use their facility for these movies. And I would say we had 75 to 80 children on a Tuesday or a Thursday morning watching these free movies with their mothers. And then on the other Tuesday or Thursday, we did an activity, and we have some photographs here that plays, all kinds of things like that, that we did activities that the children could participate in. And this was a large group of children, very diverse, from all over Slidell. We publicized it, and anybody could come, as with the movies. So this was open to all the children in Slidell, and it grew and grew and grew. So that was our initial thing. And Mae Devitt was very gracious with the library, helping us get the films and also allowing us to tie into the library and the little park that was right beside the library where we could have the activities. So that's how it started.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
And the city at that point was not providing
too
many recreation opportunities.
In Slidell, at that time, the activities for children were the youth football, youth baseball, and basketball, mainly for the boys. I don't even know if there was anything for the girls. There were some cultural things with the Nutcracker Suite, ballet. And I don't know if Slidell Little Theater had summer theater programs for the children at the time. I don't think so. Although they did shortly thereafter, they didn't at that point. All this was new, because at that point, Slidell Little Theater had just moved into the church. It had been floating around to various venues, and it had finally purchased the church. So I don't think at that point they had done any children's activities. It was just, the kids were on their own.
How did this group of mothers form the Friends of the Slidell Library?
Well, we were readers. Mm-hmm. And many of us, I should say I personally have this view that if I'm going to complain about something, I should be part of the solution. And so I realized that my vision for the library was different than what it was. And that I needed to really understand the library structure, the governing body, those types of things. And so that we could, be part of the change we wanted. And at that point, I was very active in the League of Women Voters, and T.R. Lynch, the brand new library director, came to the League of Women Voters meeting, and I approached him and said that we really would like to create a Friends of the Slidell Library. And at that point, I didn't understand that the Slidell Library is really part of the St. Tammany Parish system. I just thought, I knew there was some tie, but I didn't really understand all that. And I needed to understand more. And he said to me, well, I was welcome to try, but he didn't think that there would be much interest. And I'm sure that probably we had a few newspaper stories that we were going to create some friends, because I had learned how to use the press a little bit. And so we just picked a day and announced and really spread the word. And we had 34 people. I remember that number as clear as day. We had 34 people show up, and there were many people there I had never met before. A lot of men. Charles Diem, one in particular. He was a true joy. And so there showed that there was strong interest for Friends of the Library, and we didn't know really what we were all about. It's just that we wanted to help this library be something other than what it was. And at that point, the budget didn't seem to allow money for any improvements at the Slidell Library. So we thought we could raise some money to cause these changes that we would like to see. A greater collection, more bookshelves, stuff like that. So we did a couple things. One is we raised money, and we had suggested to Mr. Lynch that, with having people who are really knowledgeable on library equipment and those types of things, that they could come in and show how that space could be used better and how they could get more into it, and that we as Friends of the Library would raise money to create more bookshelves and things like that. So we did that. There were two things that happened right about that same time with the Friends of the Library, because the other thing is I decided that I really needed to understand the governmental structure of the library, and so I started going to board meetings, which was odd because I don't think the board had ever had a member of the public attend their board meetings prior to that, and they were only meeting four times a year. So I went to Covington to the board meeting. That was the first time I saw what the Covington Library had, plus all the stacks of books that weren't out for the public. They were back in these back rooms. At the first meeting, I remember asking the board to have their next meeting in Slidell, which would be 3 months later, because I didn't think that they had really been to the Slidell Library, even though they were on the board, and they didn't really understand the problem. And at that point, more than half the population was in Slidell. It had one library, and I think there were at least five or six other libraries serving the rest of the population, which was less than half. So out of this little tiny library, we're serving more than half the population of the parish. So they agreed to come to Slidell for the meeting. And I went around to all the newspapers and told them the library board was coming, and that invited them. And at that point, Slidell didn't have a whole lot of news. And to have I think there were four newspapers still at that time. There were four newspapers covering Slidell. So I just went to all of them and said, there's a board meeting, come. And I know at least three showed up. That meeting, they were discussing the budget. And the press asked for copies of the budget. And the board was stunned, I think, that people were asking to see copies of the budget and stuff like that. And I remember one person said, I hope this doesn't get in the newspaper. And my thought was, I certainly hope it does get in the newspaper, because I wanted the public to see the funding of the library and those types of things. So that began my involvement with the library board. And after that, the board did meet at other facilities, but mostly in Covington. And at that point, everybody that was on the library board, with the exception of, I don't even know if there was one representative from Slidell. There really wasn't much representative from the east end of the parish. Everybody was from the west end of the parish, but that's also where the parish government is and yes, those types of things. So we started attending board meetings. I just made it my business to go to every single one of them. So at that point, we also needed to raise money for what we said we wanted for the library. Yes. And the we decided to have a used book sale.
And that would have been, was the first book sale before the group was officially founded in 1976?
No, it was in 76. Okay, and we have pictures of this, the first book sale. The first book sale took place at the same time that the gazebo was dedicated in that library park. So we collected books at Judy Hagen's house. We asked for donations, and we had them in her little back porch area. And then the night before the book sale, we moved them all to the library. And then on Saturday morning, we moved them outside. Many of them were on tables, but a lot of them were on the ground, and people had to bend over. And I think we made well over $200. We were really pretty pleased with the amount of money we made. But we did have a lot of books left over, and we really didn't have a place to do it, store them. So we asked people to back their cars up, and we would pay them to let us load the trunk of their car with our leftover books. And they had, they could take them away and do whatever as they please, but we didn't. That's how we disposed of the first books from the first book sale. Afterwards, over many years, we stored books at Doris Kovalik's house in her garage. She donated her garage for many years as the storage place for the book sales. And we would go to her house, sort the books, and then we would have this mass moving of books from her house down. And at that point, we moved the library book sales to the recreation building that was just a block away from the library. Okay. It was a grand time. It was Saturday morning. We ate donuts and we sold books. And we had lots of friends. It was really a nice community event. And that continued for many years. At some point, I I believe, and I'm not sure in the order, but I think we rented a storage unit for the books, for the book sales, because we were getting lots of books. And then we asked for permission from the library to build a small building out behind that Slidell Library. And so we started storing books in there and then moving them still to the same recreation building. And I think we held all the book sales in that recreation building until this building was opened. It was a big event. And I think we started eventually having the Friday evening sales, but Saturday, we had a good time.
And membership probably increased too from
it did
as it became more popular and well known.
With the Friday night sales, the members' sales, people, and of course membership is so cheap. It still is. You know, it was $3, and so it was just, we weren't looking at membership as the revenue source. We were really looking at the book sales, which has still been, you know, the main source of revenue for this library. It actually provides a service because people have books. They don't really want to throw them away. They want to, and I think they feel good about giving the books to the library so they can be used in the book sale. And probably they buy books, the same books come back, they're sold again and again. So I think that turned out to be a godsend. And even with the day of e-readers and all those kinds of things, we still have book sales. So yeah, that's how we got it started.
Mm-hmm. And it grew over the years and raised money and provided a lot of things that weren't in the normal library budget.
Oh yes, not only physical things but programs, so many things. And the one thing about the Friends of the Library is I have to say, you know, there are a lot of friendships that were made through Friends of the Library. I mean, because if you have this real love of libraries, it's a different kind of person, and you have a different, so this is, you know, bonds you together. Mm-hmm. But and after the Friends of the Slidell Library was created, sometime shortly thereafterwards, there was a Friends of the Library in the other side of the parish that more or less encompassed the whole remainder of the parish beside. Because we were pretty focused on Slidell, mainly because it's hard being this far away from the parish seat. The government tends to focus and provide for that which is in its immediate area. And at that point we were considered very rural, even though we're the largest city in the parish. Mm-hmm. So it was always a battle to get things for Slidell, whether it was schools or whatever.
Mm-hmm. You also served on the Library Board of Control during a very important time in the library's development. Mm-hmm. Can you talk about how that came about? And
In the interim, even though the library was my main focus, I got sidetracked and was on the city council. Mm-hmm. Because there were certain things I wanted to see happen in the city of Slidell. I learned that the only way to make these things happen was to be on the inside and really work for those things. And I had a goal of accomplishing those things in 4 years. And during that time, there was a vacancy on the library board. And so I encouraged Phil Woodland, who was the minister at the United Methodist Church that had graciously allowed us to use their facility, to accept appointment to it and get our parish representatives to appoint him to the library board so that he could be an advocate for that. And he was, up until the 80s, early 80s, and then he was moved to another church in the state. And his suggestion was that I get appointed to the library board. And it seemed like that would work, even though I was on the city government at the time, city council. And actually, it turned out to be a real blessing. So I got involved in the library a board, and there's many things that I worked on for it. One was increasing the number of meetings from 4 a year to at least 6, and then almost monthly for a little bit, because we there was so much we needed to accomplish as a library, and we just couldn't do that if we only met 4 times a year. So that was one of the issues. And the second thing was Slidell needed another library. I mean, it needed another library. It needed to be bigger because, you know, if we could have hung books from the ceiling, it still wouldn't have been enough space. And the circulation was, you know, at that little facility was equal to all the other circulation in the parish. And the library staff, of which you remember shortly after that, you know, I mean, they were just working as much as they could. And it was, there was so much traffic in that facility. So, how to get another library? And at that time, the parish council, we were under parish council form of government. We were a home rule, which meant that we had the possibility of dividing the libraries. And there could have been just Slidell Library, and there could have been the rest if we could have, if the citizens said that's what they wanted. And while I was in the city council, Barry Brubacher was the city planner for the last part of my term. And he told me that there was some grant money, which we've got the name of that on this folder. We could get $20,000 to study the libraries. And I thought, oh my goodness, that's great. So we applied for this federal, or this fund. It was Coastal Energy Impact Funds. That's what it was. And because there was so much gas and oil happening in this end of the country, there was money to take care of that impact. And so we got $20,000 to deal with libraries because we were definitely impacted because there was so much oil and gas in this area. And so we wrote a grant, and we hired, we did a survey. Now, I am not sure whether we hired someone to do the survey or whether we designed it ourselves, but we did the survey. We surveyed everybody in the 8th and 9th Ward about libraries and what they wanted. And one of the main questions we asked was, would they be willing to create a library district just to tax themselves in order to have a Slidell library of the size we felt we needed? And the answer from the sample of the survey was no. It had to be paid for parish-wide. They felt like the whole parish needed to be involved and Slidell shouldn't carry its own burden. So we had to go back to square one at that point, and we hired Mr. Galvin. Mm-hmm. Hoyt Galvin, I believe his name,
yes.
And he was quite a library authority. And he helped us develop a plan so that every area in the parish got something, whether it was a new library or just toilets, literally, because there were no public toilets in the libraries at that time. So we came out with this plan. We had quite an extensive plan. We went to the police jury and asked to go on the ballot. This was in 1983. It was a plan for every library in the parish to have something. Mainly, it was going to provide a large library for Slidell and a large library for Covington, and then multiple other libraries were either going to be built, replaced, or fixed up a little bit. And this is all as a result of this grant, which we could not have done without this grant. I mean, I thank Barry Brubacher every day for this insight that we could get this money. So we have this plan, and we need to go to the voters. And there were two things on the ballot. One is the millage to build all these libraries. But also we needed operation millage, too. We had capital millage, which would be bonded, and then we would have operational millage. And so I spent pretty much all of 83 until the election campaigning. I went every place I could to explain to people what it was all about, what they personally were going to get in their area. We were on the ballot with multiple other issues. It was what you would call a free election. We didn't have to pay for it because it was a state election. Mm-hmm. So we went to the voters, and in their infinite wisdom, they said, yes, let's build libraries. But no, we are not going to operate them. So we were in a bit of a quagmire or trying to figure out what we were going to do, because we absolutely could not build these buildings and not have them open.
So the voters turned down the part, the operations millage, which would have provided enough
yes.
money to operate
right.
and staff these new buildings to be built.
Yeah, we had a bumper sticker that said, yes, libraries, yes, meaning, mm-hmm. and every time we went, we said, you have to vote yes twice. Mm-hmm. But they only voted yes once, and they voted no. And that was, let's see, that was in 83. And we were in a bit of a pickle. We had to figure out what we were gonna do. So we decided that we would go back to the voters again. Now, with my experience of going to the voters for issues for parks and stuff like that, I've learned that you really have to pick your election dates. You need to pick your voters, meaning you want to have something on the ballot either when only your voters are going to vote yes go. And so we picked a date in the spring of 1984. We had to pay for this election, except for the fact that it was the Democratic primary for the presidential, and Jesse Jackson was on the ballot. So what we did is we really targeted those people who would be going to vote for Jesse Jackson to make sure that they understood that they needed to vote for the bondage or for the millage to operate the libraries. Obviously we had a lot of other people who were interested in the libraries that went, but we did not really campaign much on that as far as informing the electorate that we were going, because there was a whole population of people that even if it was for the libraries, they did not want any additional taxes and would vote no. I really didn't want them to go to the polls. So we got the operation millage thanks to Jesse Jackson. So that's part of that story.
Wonderful. Mm-hmm. And so after that, then buildings were built and designed and opened all over the parish.
Right.
And then I believe the Slidell branch was the last one to open.
Right. The Slidell branch opened the week my daughter graduated from college. We moved to Slidell the week my daughter entered kindergarten, or within a month of her entering kindergarten. And when I went there in 1973, I thought, oh my goodness, we have got to do something because my children need to have a better library experience. And they didn't have it in Slidell. But I think they really grew to appreciate what libraries were all about, because we were constantly focused on trying to bring, library. And we would go to New Orleans. I mean, I had a New Orleans library card. I paid for it. We would go there. But also at that point, coming to the South from the North, it was a real experience too, because when I came to Slidell, there were two libraries in Slidell. One of them was very, very small, and it was in the African American part of the community. And the same thing was true in Covington. So that was a different experience for me. But shortly after I was in Slidell, the Slidell Library closed. And you can see from these pictures the very first children's events. We had you know, a totally diverse population. And we were really thrilled about that because we felt that was very important, that, you know, libraries are for everyone, right?
Can you talk a little bit about, I know you were involved in the sculpture that's in the front of the current Slidell Branch Library on Robert Boulevard. It's called the Vortex.
Right. Let me go way back that. One of the reasons I ran for the Slidell City Council is because there was really no arts program in the city that was public. There might have been a few private things, but there was nothing where we had cultural arts, particularly that involved children. And it had to be 1973. There was a program called CART, Community Arts and Residence Training, where you could get an artist to come to your community and be there for a week. They would go in the schools, they would interact with people any way you wanted to set up a program, and then they would ultimately end with a performance of their craft or their art. And I had heard about this, and Kay Cotton was a person that was instrumental, and she knew about it too. And I remember Kay Cotton called me and said, we have got to decide tomorrow if we want this money. We have an opportunity to get it. We can have an artist come to Slidell, but we've got to act on it. And there was another gentleman named Gay Calkins who was very interested in the arts in Slidell, and he was on board. And I think there must have been one other. Susan Scoggin was also involved. So the four of us, and they called me, and I said, well, okay, this is how we're going to do this. It was a little difficult for me, being the only woman on the city council, to get the majority of the eight other people, the men, to vote on these types of things within the first 3 or 4 months that I was on the council. So the way for this to happen without having to bring it up to the council and everything is I went straight to Mayor Webhart, and this was his first term, and I said to him, we really need to do something besides ban on baseball, football, everything, and this is an opportunity and it's not going to cost anything, but you need to create the Mayor's Commission on the Arts in order for it to happen. So we went to his office that morning, I remember. There was a hurricane coming, too. We were getting ready for Hurricane Bruce. So we had like maybe 20 minutes in his office. We said, it's not going to cost you any money. This is what we can do. Slidell will look good. You'll look good. And we can call it the Mayor's Commission on the Arts, and we'll move forward. And so he said, okay. And that's what we did. We created the Mayor's Commission on the Arts. We developed all these community and artist programs, and the Mayor's Commission on the Arts grew. Ultimately, the City Council didn't want it just to be the Mayor's Commission on the Arts, so it became the Commission on the Arts for the City of Slidell. And we did all these arts programs. After that, we also wanted to have a way for the citizens of Slidell to give money specifically for the arts. And the way to do that is we created the Slidell Arts Council and had multiple fundraisers, silent auctions, all those types of things that you would to raise money, and funded a lot of programs. In addition, we raised this $30,000 that was sitting there. And ultimately, the city government took over the art program and everything, and so we had this $30,000 that was sitting in this account, and decided that really what we needed to do with it is create a piece of sculpture,
a piece of art in a public place.
Yes, art in public place. Mm-hmm. And so Susan Scoggin was basically the treasurer or the keeper of the funds. I was the go-getter. And we felt like we were going to do this the right way, meaning like all the other arts in public places happen in big cities. So we created a committee of prominent art people, George Dunbar, Elizabeth McBurney, and I wish I could remember the other people, but those are two specific people I remember on it. And we had a call and got many, many submissions from artists saying they would like to create a piece. And then it was narrowed to a small number. And then from that, it was narrowed down to three artists who were paid, I think they were paid $300 to make a model of the ultimate project. We chose Skip, what was his name?
Skip or Harold Van Houten?
Yes, who designed the vortex, and this was selected by this committee of George Dunbar, Elizabeth McBurney, and several other people, and I'm sorry I can't remember their names right now. It was a very interesting thing, because this was private money being placed in a public space, which was the library board, or the library, of which the parish council owns the land. So we had to have agreements between the parish government, the library board, the sculptor, and the Slidell Arts Council treasurer. So we had quite a legal document that was, and Skip was chosen. He created this piece. I remember when it was delivered. It was a little bit of a controversy, but I think all outstanding art is a controversy. There were several pieces that were just more traditional that had been submitted, but the committee that was made the selection really felt like we needed an important piece of art. So that's how that was selected. There's been some issues with it, but you can still walk in a little bit and see out, and it's a marvelous experience to stand in and look out. And it certainly set Slidell Library apart from the rest of them in the parish, so that's good.
Can you talk a little bit, well, you have the distinction of being the first female member of the Slidell City Council.
Mm-hmm.
The first.
Right.
Can you talk a little bit about your experience campaigning for that, the election, serving on the council?
Sure. I had been in Slidell for 5 years, and like I mentioned earlier, one of the things that I truly believe in is if I'm going to complain about something, I better figure out how to fix it, or I should just not complain and keep my mouth shut. So I got really involved in various things. And one of them was the Slidell Federation of Homeowners, which there isn't a thing of that now, but there used to be like that. And we all got together and because it was a time when we had all these people coming in from other parts of the country, and we really impacted Slidell. And we were used to services that we had in our other communities, and they were not happening here. So I think I was not unique in thinking that, you know, we needed to really be part of the solution. And ultimately, time where there were some issues in Slidell based on the form of government it had. And in that time, it had a strong council and a weak mayor. It was a part-time mayor, and the council really ran the business. And there were only five councilmen. And, they were used to the rural nature of Slidell, and they knew each other. They'd gone to high school and grade school with each other. It was just a nice big family thing. And then we showed up. And I can't remember the specific issue, but there was something that really got the city excited. And we all showed up at city council meetings and basically demanded that the Slidell rewrite its form of government and to have a strong mayor and have representatives on the council, make the council larger, have people elected in districts and various things like that. So that happened. It must have happened in 76, around in there, that the incident occurred. And then shortly thereafterwards, we passed this document to provide Slidell with a new city charter. So it came time for elections, and every morning I'd get up and look at the paper and see who's running in the district that I lived in. And it kind of crossed my mind that, well, you know, I'm not really happy with who might be representing me, but really had not felt like it was time for me to do this. There had never been a woman. There had never been a damn Yankee. There had never been a Republican. So I thought, oh, no. And finally, a fellow called me that was involved with me in the charter and working on that and said that if I didn't run, I would get the representative I deserved. That was on a Thursday. Registration closed at noon on Friday. And I talked to my husband, and he said, well, he thought it was time I got a job anyhow. So I went down the next day and filled out the papers and qualified. Not organized, not knowing what I was going to do. But really thought that, you know, I ran campaigns in high school, so, you know, just get your brain working and go on it. And it was some of the interesting things about this. I laid out a plan. And running as a Republican, I thought, oh, maybe I was supposed to ask permission from the state Republican Party to even allow myself to run as a Republican. I didn't know any of this. And shortly thereafter, their state Republican Party called me, and they asked me for my plan. So I thought I had to have this huge plan. So I laid out everything I was going to do. I had the help from a person who had been previously elected statewide in the state of Louisiana, and he helped me lay out my ads, everything I was going to do. I had it laid out for the entire campaign. And I sent this off to the state of Louisiana, you know, thinking I had to ask for permission. Mm-hmm. And they immediately called me up and wanted to know where I had gone to campaign school, how I had learned to do all this and everything. And I said, no, I just ran campaigns in high school and college. That's all I knew. So we had a force of women. And it was a sweet little district. You know, it was very compact, 1,000 homes, nice, tight geographic area. And we, every week, hit that district with something. Door hanger, something. And I walked that district 3 times talking to every voter, you know, just so they'd get to know me, those types of things. It was fun. It really was fun. And for the lack of 19 votes, I had to go to a runoff. And then I went to a runoff and was ultimately elected. It was interesting because the other people who were elected with me on the city council, and this was the new government, so there was only one person that had been a holdover from the previous government, Jerry Hinton. They didn't know what to call me, you know, and I just said, just call me councilman. It doesn't, you know, that's the position in the charter, and so that worked out. It was, it always worked out well. I had some surprises. One is, I really thought that when you ran for city council that you were, that government was going to function like I had learned in high school and junior high in civics classes. We decided what was good, we voted on it, we listened to our constituents, and those types of things. I was totally surprised that, you know, other people elected with me were holding press conferences. You know, I thought, I didn't know anything about that. And then also in the course of very early in the thing, they wanted to trade votes. You know, I'll vote for this if you vote, you know, and stuff like that. And I said, no. It's too hard for me to keep bank accounts on who owes me votes and stuff like that. If I propose something and you don't think it's good legislation, please don't vote for it. On the other hand, if you know, you propose something and I don't think it's any good, I'm not going to vote for it either. But if you think it's good, then let's vote for it. One of the first things we passed was a tree ordinance in Slidell, and some of it still is around because they were just leveling trees all around, and most of us had chosen to move to Slidell because there were so many lovely trees. We passed, within the first 6 months, we passed an ethics code. That ethics code still stands, and I think that our city government in Slidell is the only government body in St. Tammany Parish where no elected official currently serving has ever been indicted for anything. It's a tight code. We did that. We passed all kinds of things. One other thing that was really interesting. At that time, Slidell had a flat water rate. You paid $4 a month, and you could have all the water you wanted. And there might have been $2 for sewerage. I don't know. It might have been a $6 bill, but you could, you know, do whatever you wanted. And, I mean, it was very wasteful. And we knew we needed to do something about it. But politically, it was not good for, especially those people who are running for re-election. And I knew I was serving only one term, so, you know, I could do all these things. So we needed some help with sewerage. We could get federal money to upgrade our sewerage plant, but only if we metered our sewerage. Well, you don't meter sewerage. You meter water, and sewerage is what is tacked on. You have a sewerage fee from it. So that really meant we needed to meter water. And we had some plans and surveys and things like that, and it was hard. It was going to be hard to get 5 votes. But I knew we needed to do it. And I put my name on the legislation because, you know, because I wasn't running again, it didn't hurt that my name was on the legislation, so I put the money in the legislation. We had the public hearings and everything, and it came time for the vote. And I got up, and I walked around, and in front of every city council member, I put a bullet, a real bullet, and I said to them, "All right, it's time to bite the bullet and do the right thing." And because that broke the tension in the room, we got enough votes to get water meters. So that was one of the things we did. So it was a wonderful experience. My children were so happy when I was no longer on the city council because they took the brunt of a lot of ugly phone calls. But I learned so much. And then I could go on and really work for the libraries, which is what I really wanted to do in the first place. Yeah.
And Judy, you served on the library board from October of 1980 through February of 1985. Mm-hmm. What things happened during that time period that you're particularly proud of, or do you find interesting?
One is we had to hire a new library director. T.R. Lynch resigned rather abruptly. And fortunately you were employed at that time, so you could step in as interim library director. And I really felt that we needed to do a nationwide search. At that time, we knew we were going to have this great building project, which I felt would be very interesting to somebody in libraries because they could have a great impact on it. And I had read How to Hire a Library Director from various library publications and do a library search. And one of the things I had said to the board at the time, and I was president of the board at the time, was that we were going to do everything in the open. There would be nothing happen behind closed doors, including the interview process. So we determined the criteria, advertised nationally, and asked for applications, the people who were interested. And I believe we got about 30 applications. And from that, we narrowed it, I believe, to 10. That we were interested in. All these meetings and all the applications were in the public. And we had told the applicants this would happen in the public. And then we had a written interview with these 10 for them to give more in-depth answers to questions that we were interested in. And we got some very interesting responses. And it became apparent that we could whittle that list down from their responses. And I believe we got it down to three. And we decided that we would bring these people in for personal interviews and tour the parish. The interviews were held in the public. Any member of the community could come. So the press was there for all of it. We did, I mean, even when we whittled the list down to from 10 to 3, that was done in public. Everything was done so that there was nothing hidden. We initially made an offer to one gentleman in Mississippi, and interestingly enough, he used us as leverage to get what he wanted in his own county library, which was all right. But we were fortunate enough that Elizabeth Roundtree, who was our second choice, was in Orleans Parish and very well qualified. It was wonderful. And she came over and really took St. Tammany to the next level of libraries, computers, all kinds of, she had a great vision for libraries, and she was the right woman at the time. One of the other interesting things was, and I can relate with you because you were on the, at the time, we would go to these national meetings, and there were books on tape, and I thought, oh, wonderful, we should add books on tape to the collection, because it's particularly in Slidell, we had so many people commuting, and we had people commuting in Covington. Everybody was going to the South Shore to work, and so why not give them books on tape to listen to, and that was before CD players, everything, and I had proposed this to the library board about it, and a few people felt like libraries were for books and that we didn't really need to provide books on tape. So I came back to the friends and said, well, maybe we can do it in Slidell and, you know, and have the friends buy the and make that part of the collection. So that's how we initially got books on tape. Let's see, and then of course was the building of the new libraries, all those types of things. And all the extensive planning that was involved with this. Once we realized we were gonna have to do 10 projects, there was one point where the library, the parish council, I believe it was a police jury then, because it went from parish council to police jury back to parish council, decided they were going to hire the architect way before we had done any planning. But in this area, just because the library board did all the campaigning, got the issue passed and everything, they did not have the right to spend the money. The police jury had the right to select the architects, buy the property, everything. They spent the money. And way before we were going to decide what was going to happen, they wanted to hire one architect. And Mr. Lynch was on the library, or was library director at the time, and we showed up in mass at the police jury meeting, and he made an impassioned plea that, you know, this was not the way it should happen, that the board who they had appointed should have some say in the architects, those types of things.
Wasn't there a citizens committee that explored pieces of property
right.
in the Slidell area extensively
right.
and made a recommendation that a particular
right.
piece of property be purchased?
Mm-hmm. There was, I think there were 10 people on that committee, including the engineer for the city of Slidell, I know, and library people, board people, community leaders. There were 10 people on that committee, I remember that. And we had a criteria that came from the American Library Association on how to select library sites. And we toured sites. One of the interesting things is there were multiple sites offered. By that I mean about three or four. And then at the last minute, there was a site on Fremo that was offered that was 3 acres. The site that this particular library is on, 2.5 acres. The recommendation was a 3-acre site. there was a real push from particularly South Slidell to have it at least in mid-city, if it couldn't be in South Slidell. And so we toured all the sites, we looked at all the criteria, the pros and cons, and the library board, based on the recommendation of the committee, the site selection committee, took it to the library board, and then the library board recommended to the parish police jury that they purchase a piece of property on Fremo Avenue. Well, I went home. We had done our work. I had been really involved, and I flew home to visit my family in Ohio. And then there was a police jury meeting. And lo and behold, the police jury totally rejected the recommendation of the library board and the site selection committee and selected this site on Slidell, in North Slidell and Robert Road. And I flew home, went to the next police jury meeting, and I've never presented something so, because I was not a happy camper. I felt that they had rejected the trust that the citizens had given the library and those of us who had campaigned to make the right selection. They had rejected the wishes of the citizens of Slidell, and they had made a decision to purchase this piece of property up here, which was $130,000 more. It was a smaller piece of property, and it was in North Slidell. The police jury said they would reconsider, but I knew that was just a formality. And I decided that my time on the library board was over. Mm-hmm. And that day I resigned. It was bittersweet. But I also felt very comfortable that Elizabeth Roundtree was very strong. She was an excellent library director, and she could make it happen. And that I needed to let go of it because it was becoming too personal. Mm-hmm. And so it was time to move on. And it took a long time to get this library built. And I think there were a lot of issues with it. And I don't think it was any one particular person's fault. It was multiple different things that just didn't align, you know, between the bankruptcy of the contractor, the roofing material, and all those things. So. But we have the library, and it's really great. I think the improvements that have happened in the last couple of years are excellent. I think it's nice that ultimately there's going to be a new library in South Slidell to serve those people. I think the all the programs at the library, when you consider that in 1973 there were no programs in the library system whatsoever, and you look at the calendar and it's just full of library programs, that you have not only a children's librarian, which you didn't have before, and reference librarians, and just so much resource. You have a teen librarian. You know, this has turned out to be the library I dreamt for. You know, it's just, I couldn't ask for more. And I would say that now I live in Lacombe, and it's Lacombe's turn. Yes. You know, and if I were going to be in the area more, I would probably try to get back on the board to get Lacombe its due. But yeah, I've had a wonderful 40-some years here in this community. And the library's always been the central part of it. So I feel really fortunate. I thank you for asking me to tell my story.
Well, it's been a pleasure talking to you. Mm-hmm. And you have been an instigator locally. I mean, we wouldn't probably be here if you had not made all the contributions that you've made
to
city government, the library, and the greater Slidell area.
Well, thank you.
So it's very nice.
Loved it.
Thank you.
Thank you.